Welcome back to Medical Today, episode 8, with me, Jared Ratnam. And we now move into gynecological disorders. Joining me in the studio is Dr. Sharina Mohammad Razali. She's a consultant obstetrician and gynecologist from KPJ Damansara Specialist Hospital. Doc, thank you very much for taking time off to be with us.
A lot to talk about
when we talk about women problems. So we're just going to dive into it straight away and talk about gynecological disorders. Now, they say that in the life of a woman, you know, at some point in their lives, they'll always face some gynecological problems, complications. Now, you know, how do we begin this conversation talking about gynecological disorders?
Okay, so
what's the most important at this point?
Well, gynecological problem is one of the most common reason why a woman would go to a GP or a clinic. So being a woman, there are so many organs, there's many things that you need to take care of, right from the uterus, the ovaries, the cervix, and also the vagina. Mm-hmm. So each of these organs has its own set of problems, okay? Well, some are common, some are less common. So if you're talking about bleeding disorder, menstrual problems, those are related to the uterus. Or sometimes a woman may come with abdominal swelling, lumps and bumps that they're not supposed to have. Then that could be actually a growth, which can come from either the uterus or also mm-hmm. the ovaries. And the most common one, at least, every woman has had at one point in their life complain of a vaginal discharge. This is probably the most common reason why they go to a clinic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's mm-hmm. obviously arising from problems in the vagina and also the cervix.
Right, okay, so let's begin at the very beginning. If you want to talk about vaginal discharge, what are the common problems which lead to vaginal discharge mm-hmm. and why are we seeing a prevalence of vaginal discharge?
Yeah, because it's very common because the vagina is very unique. You know, it has its own flora organism in the vagina that's taking care of the harmony of the vagina. Mm-hmm. Certain bacteria is, you know, making sure that the vagina stays in a very acidic component. But little things can cause disruption to this harmony. For example, intercourse, menstrual bleeding, or if they've just taken a broad spectrum antibiotics, so these good bacteria can die off, so the acidity becomes less, then you can get all sorts of problems like overgrowth of the fungal or overgrowth of the bad bacteria, giving rise to discharge. Mm-hmm.
Mm. Now, when you talk about broad spectrum antibiotics, mm-hmm. You say it will bring about problems where it eradicates some of the
good bacteria.
Yep,
that's right.
Mm-hmm. What can be done to change that process?
This goes back to good practice in the GP settings. You mm-hmm. know, when people come with cough and cold, most of the time it's actually viral. So you don't really need to give all these broad spectrum antibiotics in the first instance, in the mm-hmm. first setting. So yeah, we have to educate our GPs and all.
So GPs, mm-hmm. The first line of defense need to be re-educated with regards to ONG.
Not to over-treat a viral infection. Mm-hmm. Yep. That's
now, a lot of women in this day and age do a lot of reading on their own, especially when they find some problems within themselves. Because this goes back to being private. You know, as a woman, some women like to be private, and then even if they're married or if they have partners, mm-hmm. they don't tell their partners what's going on with their life. So sometimes you find a bit of a disharmony in a relationship because of womanly problems and because of them not being able to share these problems. Have we seen a rise in the fact that women, when they have these problems, they want to mm-hmm. share it with other people or especially with their doctors?
Well, not every woman is like brave enough or, you know, comfortable enough talking about their problems to the husbands or to the family. Some may resort to going to the doctor because they find it easier to talk to the doctor. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
say let's take something as common as STD or an STI in a setting like ours in an Asian country or in mm-hmm. a country like mm-hmm. Malaysia, and you know, to tell someone I'm suffering from an STI or an STD is like a big no-no. You know,
yes.
It's like everyone will know I had sex.
You know, STI is pretty much something that they don't talk about. You know, mm-hmm. That's the problem when they keep the symptoms to themselves. Either they try self-medication or mm-hmm. you know, just leaving it until it gets worse, and that's when the problem will happen.
Right.
That, you know, like, because as you know, STI can spread to cause like ascending infection into the pelvis. Mm-hmm. Then they can get complications of all these cervicitis. They can get complications like pelvic inflammatory diseases, which in turn can, you know, disrupt the anatomy and all that, and eventually can cause infertility, difficulty in conceiving. Mm-hmm. So I think our women should be empowered, that they should know that if they have a problem, they should be able to talk to someone and they should get help early rather than later. For example, you're talking about STI. Mm-hmm. Let's take an example, chlamydia, okay? So it's probably underdiagnosed because people don't really go and see the doctor for a discharge. They will wait until like the end, until they started to have fever, they start to have, you know, like abdominal discomfort and all that. Then they go see a doctor for, mm-hmm. you know, at that time, the infection has already spread. And once it's ascend into the pelvis, into the pelvic cavity, then it has become a pelvic inflammatory disease. So this will definitely require more urgent treatment and attention by the doctor. So it's better to seek treatment
so
earlier than
symptoms,
later.
Okay, what would the early symptoms of chlamydia be? Like you said fever. So, you know, when you get a fever, it can be for many different reasons.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Right. It depends on, like, all women will have some kind of discharge. But if they feel that it's just getting worse, it's starting to have, you know, like I said earlier, pelvic discomfort, pain during intercourse, you know, and the smell of the discharge is becoming very offensive, then they should seek help.
Right.
Yeah. If it's like a simple one, whitish discharge at certain time of the month, that could be physiological. You know, when you're getting your period, when you're ovulating, you do have some kind of discharge.
Right.
But a woman should know, should be able to tell when the discharge is not the usual one. Yeah, that's when they need to come and seek help.
Now, the executive producer of the show did talk about, you know, brought up this problem, uterus polyps versus fibroids. I think, you know, while it's important to talk about that, we also need to talk about cysts. So, you know, how do we tell the difference between the two or the three?
All right, so fibroids are actually a solid growth that arises from the uterus, okay? Actually, if you look at the statistics...
Thick muscle tissue.
Yes. So if you look at the statistics, those days they used to say about 30% of women will have fibroid whether they know it or not. But if, as these women grow older, it, the data can, the numbers can go up to as high as 70% in the woman age 50 and above. So it's actually a very common growth in women. But unfortunately, only some will become symptomatic. So the symptoms that can have, they can give, the fibroid can give rise to symptoms like abdominal swelling, pain during period, during menses, and also abnormal bleeding, like very heavy period bleeding. So that's fibroid, okay?
Polyps, so on the top of your usual menstrual pains, you get, it becomes acute.
Yes, it becomes more severe. That you know, like limiting their physical activity, they can't go to work when they're having their period, so that's not normal. So on the other hand, polyps are actually smaller growth. Okay, there is, can be just a small bump or like a small little mushroom that can arise from any cavity in the body. So it can come from the nasal cavity, it can come from the stomach and stomach polyp, it can also come from the bowel and gastrointestinal. But I'm going to talk about obviously endometrial and cervical polyp.
Yeah, endometrial tissues.
Yes.
Yeah.
So so endometrial polyp tend to give rise to, again, same will be abnormal bleeding.
Okay, what is an endometrial polyp?
It's an abnormal growth from abnormal cell proliferation arising from the endometrial cavity.
Right.
Yeah. So in gynae, you can have polyp coming from either the endometrium, which is inside the uterus, or coming from the cervix. So both will cause like abnormal bleeding. Bleeding in between periods, bleeding after intercourse. So, yeah.
So it has its fair share of problems, and you need to establish or ascertain it by checking with a doctor if it's a polyp or if it's fibroids. Now, with regards to cysts, what don't we know, or what we are, do we now know about cysts?
Cyst is actually a growth containing mostly fluid. The fluid can be straw, can be a clear fluid, can be straw-colored fluid, or it can also be like old blood that's collected in the body. The thing about cysts, they can become asymptomatic because cysts in gynae, cysts arises from ovary. They can grow to a considerably large size before they become noticeable or symptomatic, because you know, at the first instance when there's a cyst, there's not much symptoms. Unless it has grown so big until the woman will notice an abdominal swelling. Then only they will, you know, prompt them to go see a doctor, and voila, they already have like a 16 centimeter cyst arising in the abdominal cavity. So that's a different lah. The presentation cyst usually will be later.
Right. Yeah. Right. So fibroids, polyps, you know, a lot of people, when they Google it, the first thing they come up with, you know, it can lead to cancer, irregular menstrual periods, and instability of your normal cycles. There's also vaginal bleeding, there's infertility, all these things that can scare you. So what do we need to know about polyps and also fibroids with regards to how serious it can get to?
So basically, whenever a woman has abnormal bleeding, abnormal uterine bleeding, a bleeding that is like outside their period, you know, like following intercourse and all that, they should see a gynecologist, you know, to get at least to get a scan. Okay, so that will help to, you know, rule out all this growth, and they can also investigate. Some investigation can be done. For example, any woman who has had sex should at least do a pap smear. So when they come to a doctor, the gynae will see this as opportunity to also screen the patient for all these cervical cancer malignancies.
Now, when you talk to women about, I'm just going to digress a little and talk about vaccines, because you know, when you talk about the HPV, and all the vaccines that are required by young girls these days, or girls who are going to be sexually active.
Right.
There was a time when they said that, you know, if you're already sexually active, the vaccines won't quite help. So it needs to happen before you're sexually active.
It will offer the best protection if the vaccine is given before sexual activity, because then she'll be covered against all the different types of HPV virus. Let's say she has had intercourse already, so she's already exposed to some. So the vaccine will not offer the best protection, but it's still beneficial to be given, because I think the vaccine supplier
that's the thing. You know, a lot of people are now saying that Big Pharma is promoting that, you know, when you're sexually active, it still helps, but they don't tell you why and how.
Because they are actually doing, there's a lot of studies ongoing that suggest that even you have been exposed, you can still get some benefit from the vaccine that you're going to get, because the vaccine, for example, the latest one is covering against 9 types of HPV virus. So you may be exposed to only 1 or 2. So you can get still protection from the other 7.
Right.
Yeah.
It's very interesting. I spoke to another gynecologist a long time ago, and he said, you know, the best present you can give a 16-year-old is a
HPV vaccine.
Vaccine. Yeah. And for you to talk to Malaysians with regards to getting your 16-year-old daughter vaccinated in case she becomes sexually active, now, how do you even start that conversation?
Well, I would definitely vaccinate my girls.
My daughter won't have sex. You know, you get stuff like, yeah, but it is...
Being in this part of the world...
You understand where I'm coming from, isn't it?
Yeah. Being in this part of the world, being Asian, and you know, like, this part of the world, parents don't really talk to their kids about sex education and all that. But I think these parents need to be informed, you know, the benefit that the girls are going to get from this vaccination.
Right.
Yeah, you can potentially save them from getting the infection. And later, we're talking about actually preventing cancers, because HPV virus has been proven to be like very, very closely related to cervical cancer. They are the one that cause like all this abnormal cell proliferation, you know, that can eventually lead to cancer. So since we've found the causal factor here, I think we should do something to stop this.
So let's use this part of the interview as a PSA. So your advice to parents, if they have growing girls in their house, is to get them vaccinated.
Yes, I would say so. Yes, please get the girls vaccinated before they embark on, you know, sexual activity, so they can get the most protection from the the vaccine. Yeah.
Right. Now let's move on to uterine fibroids, you know, and pregnancy.
Okay.
So when you talk about fibroids, especially uterine fibroids, they say it in most cases it affects pregnancy. Yeah. Is that true to say that in most cases it affects pregnancy?
Yes, a pregnancy with the uterine fibroid is definitely considered a complicated pregnancy, a high risk pregnancy. This mother is not going to experience the same, you know, smooth sailing pregnancy like anybody. It's like someone, the woman without a fibroid. Okay, the main thing is that you can have increased risk of miscarriage when you're pregnant with a fibroid. That's in the first trimester, either it be a miscarriage or you can have abnormal bleeding also. And then eventually when you enter the second trimester, as the uterus grows bigger, you know, because of all the hormonal stimulation, the fibroid also tend to get bigger. So definitely you're gonna have a uterus that's larger than dead, you know. So you're like carrying the baby.
So
and
what
growing
can
fibroid
be done at that point in the second trimester?
It's difficult because we try not to do any surgery on the uterus when the uterus is pregnant. Yeah, so basically we will have to manage expectantly until delivery.
Right.
So they will have to be informed all the risks. For example, in the first trimester we miscarriage and bleeding. Right. And in the second trimester, when the fibroid becomes too big, it sometimes can outgrow its own blood supply. That's when the patient can have a lot of pain.
Right.
Yeah.
From that, I wanted to very quickly digress to do's and don'ts during pregnancy. Now, OTC medications, are they safe to be used during a pregnancy?
Well, actually, there's not a lot of data regarding the safety of OTC medications. They are, in general, considered to be safe because you can get them without doctor's prescription.
Right.
Right? So, I mean, it's based on the doctor's experience. You know, like, for example, paracetamol. Okay. You know, I think most pregnant women has had taken paracetamol before, but luckily, it's one of the safe ones. And it can be taken across all trimesters. So, people take paracetamol for some fever, for some, you know, general painkiller and all that. So, it's fine. Then the next one I think would be common would be for your cough and cold.
Right.
So actually, only clofaniramine is the only medication that's not contraindicated in all trimester, but it's a bit sedative, so makes the mom a bit sleepy. But I guess the best advice is to go and see your obstetrician, you know, so that he or she can prescribe you the right medication with the least side effect to the baby.
Right. Of course, I'm asking you a list of questions given to me by a bunch of women now. The second question is it okay to have a feeling of cramping or have some bleeding during pregnancy?
Cramp in the early pregnancy is actually very common because it's actually caused by the changes in the uterus. You know, there's a growing baby there and the uterus is also growing in size, so you expected to have some kind of cramps. It's very common that my patients come and tell me, I feel like I'm getting my period, doctor, but I'm already pregnant, is that all right? So that's actually very common. And some light bleeding is also, not to say normal, but you can expect a little bit of minimal PV bleeding in the early part of the pregnancy because of the hormonal and all that. So your uterus become, your cervix becomes very sensitive.
Right.
So when you're coughing or you're like a lot, doing a lot of walking or even sexual intercourse, you can have a bit of bleeding afterwards. So that's quite normal. You can just go and see your obstetrician, get a scan. If the heartbeat is there, it's fine. So you can just continue the pregnancy.
Right. This next question comes from a friend of mine who's a rather vain person. Okay. Even when she sleeps, she needs to look good. So her question is, how much weight should one gain in pregnancy? She's worried about not looking good while she's pregnant.
Well, across the board, usually the acceptable weight gain in pregnancy is about 11 to 15 kilo. This for a mother with a normal BMI. If the mother is underweight, obviously you can allow a bit more weight gain, probably up to 18 kilos. But if the mom is already obese, you know, with high BMI to begin with, so the weight gain is a little bit reduced. You want to limit it around 8-9 kilos altogether.
So if they already when their BMIs are quite high and they're pregnant, what is your go-to advice with regards to, you know, making your
weight gain optimum?
Optimum, and also, you know, when you deliver, you want to be in the best in the pink of health as much as possible, simply because you don't want any complications. So what would be your advice?
My advice would be, I mean, first of all, I would refer them to dietitian.
You need strength to give birth, you know, I mean.
Yeah. I will definitely refer them to the dietitian so they can get some advice on, you know, calorie counting and their requirement, what
do
to eat, what not to eat
during pregnancy.
Yeah, well, they will have to, because I'm going to be monitoring their weight gain.
Right. So every time they come in, they're not going to hear the end of it.
You know, so they still need to gain some weight. Yeah, so they have to restrict the weight gain, you know, and then, sorry, you were saying about obese?
About being a bit overweight while you're pregnant.
Because they have to be advised that when you're pregnant with a high BMI, there are bound to be complications. You know, your chances of cesarean section is a bit higher, you know, your labor tend to be prolonged, and then you're at risk to develop all these medical complications in pregnancy, for example, gestational diabetes mellitus.
Right.
So that's why it's very important to follow the dietitian's advice, you know, and to stick to the recommended weight gain and not to exceed beyond.
Right. With gestational diabetes, it's also interesting to see that some women, after they deliver, of course, most of them come back to normal, but some women continue to have diabetes. What are the complications therein?
Well, women with diabetes in pregnancy, they're actually risk to get diabetes in later life is a lot higher than women who doesn't have. So for those who remain diabetic at the end of the postpartum period, they are more likely to actually have the diabetes already even before they're pregnant. It's just that it's not diagnosed earlier. So definitely they will have to be referred to the physician and the endocrinologist to help monitor, because diabetes mellitus, as you know, is a condition without no apparent symptoms. They might go on happy with their life, eating, not restricting their not taking care of their diet, but without any symptoms.
With diabetes mellitus, it's clearly said that if you start to get dry throat, your lips are dry, you're thirsty, these should be alarm bells ringing.
That's
already,
right.
You know. But of course, you know, some of us are hypochondriacs, so we take these things more seriously than
but
others.
But some are not. Some are just like, you know, like, oh, I'm just thirsty, you keep on drinking. And then they can be actually diabetic for a few years even before they realize it.
Okay, so saying just before delivery, with gestational diabetes, you get really high blood sugar level. The levels are really high. What do you do then?
In the labor process, they'll be monitored with insulin.
With insulin,
yes. In the antepartum period, they will be seen a dietitian, and they'll be advised to monitor their blood sugar. They will have to produce a blood sugar profile, we call it.
Right.
That's when they have to prick themselves and give the doctor, show the doctor their reading, the reading of the sugar in a day. So there are a few readings that they have
so
to do.
So you have to do it on your own? And
they will be taught to do it, and then they have to do it themselves.
So that also will be checked against an A1C?
They have to bring their sorry?
Will A1C be taken also?
Yes. Because so some are very naughty. You know, the day they're doing their blood sugar profile, they really will behave themselves. But on other days, they just binge on all the brownies.
They won't eat from 5 p.m. Yes.
That's when the HbA1c comes in handy.
Going back to more questions from women, what are the recommended vaccinations during pregnancy and when?
Okay, so...
Is that a valid question?
Yes. First, you will be talking about influenza because it's safe to be given in pregnancy. So we should take, any adults should take influenza yearly, every year. So it can also be given to pregnant women, especially when they're pregnant around influenza season or they're planning to go travel where there's a lot of influenza going on. Then next one will be the TDAP. It's actually tetanus, diphtheria and acellular pertussis vaccine. This one can be given...
Can you just slow it down?
TDAP, okay. For tetanus, diphtheria and I get that a lot.
Right.
And acellular pertussis.
Okay.
Okay, so this is usually given after the 27 weeks up to the 36 weeks. The reason why we're giving is because we have been given this vaccine when we're younger. But, you know, our body tend to forget, you know, the antibodies we know. So you have to like boost the production of this antibody. And these antibodies can be passed on to the neonates, to the newborn. So the baby will be affected as well.
Right.
Especially it is nowadays, we hear a lot about anti-vaxxers. And you see like old disease resurfacing, people dying from TB, people dying from diphtheria.
What should we do with these people, the anti-vaxxers?
Oh, I have to talk to the minister.
Is it safe to exercise and what sort of diet should one follow? Of course, this is a very general question. I think this question, that there's a lot of depth to this question, we'll get to that.
Take a whole topic on its own.
So is it safe to exercise? Also, I think in a roundabout way, she's asking,
do I have to exercise?
Do I have to exercise? And can I, you know, get jiggy with it during pregnancy?
It's safe to exercise in pregnancy,
okay,
provided you know your limitations. If you are someone who has never had exercise before in your life, don't suddenly try to start exercising in pregnancy and like doing vigorous exercise. So you know your limitations. Maybe you want to start small, maybe 10 minutes walk 3 times a week, you know, and you increase it from there on. Okay, and you have to know there are certain exercise that's not recommended in pregnancy. For example, with the risk of falling, you don't want to fall when you're pregnant. You can cause injury to yourself, you know, when there's sudden trauma to the abdomen, that's going to increase risk to the pregnancy. So the safe exercise to be done in pregnancy would be brisk walking. You know, just take a walk in the park or around your housing area, and swimming, of course, because in the water you're like protected from any kind of injury.
One final question from a list of questions sent to us by women: what pregnancy symptoms are normal and what's an emergency? That's a very good question.
Again, a very broad topic. We started with cramps just now,
right?
Remember I told you cramp was actually very common and can be normal in pregnancy, but they should know that if the cramps doesn't go away, okay, or if the cramps gets worse and the bleeding increases, and you have to think about miscarriage and all that. So that's not normal, and you should see the obstetrician. Okay, you should also look out for other symptoms like pain during passing urine, cramps, and then pain when passing urine. You have to think about urine infection, and again, will require you to see the doctor. And this is talking about the first trimester. Going into the second and third trimester, of course, bleeding again is not normal in pregnancy. You have to rule out all the causes related to the placenta, whether the placenta is normally situated or the placenta is healthy, whether there's any premature separation, all the causes. So again, you need to see the doctor. This is talking about cramps and bleeding. Then I guess when you go to the doctor for your normal antenatal visit, there are a few things that they will look at. For example, your blood pressure and the presence of protein in the urine. This again to try to screen for preeclampsia, which is hypertension in pregnancy. Again, not normal.
So hypertension in pregnancy is not normal. Gestational diabetes which brings me to, now that we've talked quite a bit or extensively pregnancy about the technicalities, but you know, I mean, we covered enough ground, it's time to move into you being a doctor and talking to people. And it's a little something we talked about off the airwaves. You know, like for me, it's always a wonder how doctors have to break bad news to their patients, you know, if one's got cancer or if there's some complications with pregnancy in your area of speciality, you need to break bad news to a couple or to a person. How do you do it?
Well, it's never easy. You know, first of all, you have to be very sensitive to what the patient is going to feel. You know, breaking bad news is not easy. You might want to bring her to a room Okay, and then make sure you switch off your handphone. You want ask her whether she wants someone to come with in with her to you know, to listen into the conversation. She wants somebody to be there for her. And then I will slowly tell the patient. I usually start the conversation. For example, like a woman who just lost her baby. I would just start the conversation by saying, this is not an easy thing to tell you. I myself have never experienced this, so I know it's not, I can never understand the sadness that you're going to go through, but I'm very sorry. I have to tell you that your baby has passed away in the womb, mm-hmm. Okay? And
so I think the
I'm just going to give you a minute, and right. then you can always, you can ask me anything that you want to ask me later.
Mm-hmm. What's, I know this is putting you on the spot, but what's the worst you had to do as a doctor in order to break a piece of news to someone?
You yeah, know, why, there was this lady, she was followed up somewhere else. She was told everything was fine. But when she came to my hospital, I was working in PPUM that time. I was still a registrar. So she was referred to the hospital because the baby has had a very bad structural abnormality that will result in the baby dying soon after birth. So I was working with the high-risk pregnancy team at that time. The finding was confirmed by my professor. So I was the one assigned to break the news. The husband did not take it well. He was like shouting and screaming. Mm-hmm. Because they had been following up somewhere and they were told that everything was fine, right? Until like at 38 weeks, this is just like near birth, near delivery time. Then bam, someone told you them that the baby has got, you know, some congenital problems. So it took me quite some time to like to calm them down and, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. to...
I mean, doing ONGs or specializing in this field, I guess there's a lot you have to take into consideration, especially when speaking to people now.
Yes.
Before I let you go, what would your message be to all of us with regards to understanding the work of an ONG specialist or an obstetrician and gynecologist?
Mm. In private practice or in
yeah,
the
in
government?
Yeah, in private practice, yeah. yeah. I mean, we expect a lot from you, you know,
yeah.
especially when we go to private healthcare, we
yes.
expect a lot from people
yes.
like you. But also, there's a flip side to it, which is problems within your work or areas that, you know, sometimes which is beyond your control. So what would you like to tell the all of us with regards to dealing with an obstetrician, gynecologist? And also, you know, like a lot of us like to go doctor shopping these days. You
yeah.
know, yeah. And we do it very openly. I think it's a bit crude, but yeah.
Okay. Being a private obstetrician and gynecologist in a private setting, it's not an easy job. Because
mm-hmm.
when patient comes and start their follow-up with me, they would expect me to deliver their baby, okay? And as much as possible, I would also want to be there during the delivery time. But I guess they have to understand that sometimes things do happen, you know, you get... Because we are also at the same time human being. I have family and I have my husband and my kids. So if we have like emergency at home, then you cannot come on time, then I hope my patient will expect the fact that, you know, like they can accept the fact that they may be delivered by someone else. That's one thing. And I think sometimes patients tend to request phone number from their doctor.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it depends, you know. If like, I try not to give, but there are certain circumstances when it's like a high-risk pregnancy and this patient is very concerned. You know, I do tend to give, but I really would request that they respect the trust that the doctor
the
is giving.
The privacy of the... Yeah.
Yes, this is a privilege to, I mean, only call when you really need to, when there's a really, really emergency, and not to just call and chat. And, you know, because mm-hmm. we are, at the end of the day, we are human beings.
Right.
Yeah, and I'm already giving like half of my life for my patients, so I need some time for my kids and my family
yeah.
at home as well. So, yeah.
On that note, thank you very much, Dr. Sharina Mohammad Razali, consultant obstetrician and gynecologist from KPJ Damansara Specialist Hospital. It was a pleasure and honor having you on the show.
Thank you,
Gerard. We're going to take a short break and we'll come back with more for you on Medical Today.